The following is an exclusive presentation of HDNet. He has one of the most recognizable names in mixed martial arts history. But before taking the sport by storm, Frank Shamrock was a ship without a rudder. Bouncing in and out of foster homes as a child, constantly in trouble with the law as a teenager, Shamrock finally found his footing when his adopted father introduced him to the world of MMA. Shamrock fought his way to the top, becoming the first king of Pancrase. But it was his success in the UFC that earned him the moniker The Legend. This week, Frank the Legend Shamrock is our guest on Fighting Words with Mike Straka. From HDNet, this is Fighting Words with Mike Straka. This week, Mike welcomes Frank Shamrock. Now, your host, Mike Straka.
Welcome to the program, Frank Shamrock.
Thanks, Mike.
All right, so you've been on both sides of the fence as a fighter, and you see a lot of the promotion side now in your duties as a broadcaster and working behind the scenes with Strikeforce. What have you learned that you didn't learn when you were on the fighter side about the sport and about the business?
Wow, that's a lot of stuff. When you're a fighter, you're very protected. You're in your own little world because you have a very precise task you're going to do. So you really are clueless to the organization, everything else that goes on, even just people to get you from point A to point B. Being on the other side has really allowed me to see what type of depth is inside these productions and what it really takes to get, you know, a live broadcast off, which is just crazy.
Did it give you a newfound respect for the promoters of the sport, knowing what they have to go through to get a show like this and to get it on the air, to get it on TV, to get it on pay-per-view, to put the cage up, to do all the kinds of things that they have to do?
Yeah, I mean, I've been a promoter, so I've respected the promoter status. I quit because it's a lot of babysitting and hand-holding, and I'm more of the get it done kind of guy. Close your fists, get it done. And there's always a battle between the promoter and the talent, because one guy's, you know, trying to get something out of you and you're providing it. Being that guy really helped me understand what the fighter needs, mm-hmm. because I've been on both sides. So it just helped me understand what he needs. A lot of stuff you don't need, but some stuff you honestly, as a fighter, you need water. You need, you know, you need basic things, and those are really important.
You are in the game EA MMA as a fighter and as a broadcaster.
Yep.
Can you comment on your own fight?
I don't know how much I can say, EA Sports, but they'll get me in trouble if I do. But I can say that we are toying with the idea of having me be able to commentate over my own character and then making that more of a fun kind of insider's joke, because no one's ever done it before.
Are you happy with the way you look in the game?
No, I look old. So I don't remember myself. I know I'm old, but I don't remember myself looking that old. So I was shocked by how old I looked. But at the same time, I was young and fresh and very technical. So it made me feel good about it.
Were you shocked at how old you looked versus Nick Diaz?
No. You know, that is honestly the only time I ever went in and couldn't perform. Injury, it doesn't matter. I've always performed. I've always been able to do it. And that night, for a number of reasons, mostly physical and some mental, I couldn't perform. And it's never happened to me. I went in with a broken leg and a broken hand and fought any way you could imagine. But it was a good eye-opener for me. You know, I realize I do too much. I mean, I have a job in every, you know, area of the sport because I really love it and I believe in it. I want it to be the greatest sport in the world like it's supposed to be. But that was my wake-up call that I do too much. I got to stop and focus on what is most important to me. And fighting is really important to me. So I'm going to get back to whooping butt and not getting my butt whipped, because I didn't like that feeling.
Well, what is most important to you?
Family. Most important thing to me in the world is providing for my family. You know, I wake up with my daughter every morning, and it's always, morning, Nicolette.
Morning, Daddy.
How'd you sleep? Good. I love you. Every morning. I grew up very alone, and I grew up always needing and wanting someone to say I love you.
How did you take your father's death?
I didn't take it very well. I mean, we knew it was coming for a long time, and I went up and said goodbye to him a couple years ago because I knew that he wasn't going to recover from his last heart attack and the stroke and everything. It just took a big piece of me when he died. And I didn't get to say, I said goodbye, but I didn't get to say the things that I wanted to say to him. And that, you know, that almost still hurts me.
What'd you want to say to him?
I just want to tell him thank you. And I never really got to say thank you. You know, he didn't have to help me. He didn't have to do anything for me. He didn't have to adopt me. And he didn't have to do it for any of the thousands of people he did it for. But, you know, for me, you know, he was the first man to ever say, I love you. And you're okay. You know, and I didn't have a dad. So that meant a lot to me. And, you know, that was tough.
A lot of people credit martial arts for saving their lives. I mean, whether they're in the cage or whether they own a school, whether they're just students who all of a sudden get better grades because they're more disciplined. How does martial arts affect people in a positive way?
Well, it gives you a cloth to live by. And a lot of people that are in trouble, like I was in trouble, man. I didn't have a path to go. I didn't have a dad. I didn't have anything to say, this is how you live your life. So for me, I mean, you know, Bob was the first guy to slap me over the head and say, look, you know, there's rules and you gotta abide by them. But martial arts was the first thing that gave me a common goal that we all shared and then a place to go do it. You know, I tell people the gym is my church because that's where I go to get my salvation. That's where I go to do my thing. You know, most people don't know this, and here's your exclusive. I was in prison before I was fighting. I came out of prison and went right into fighting because I was a criminal. Really, I grew up in a broken home with addicted parents. I was abused, I was tortured, I was everything you could imagine happened to me. And I found crime to be the perfect outlet. And I wasn't a bad person, I didn't hurt people, but I took what I wanted and did what I wanted because that's what was done to me. And Bob was the guy, and martial arts was the thing that said, that doesn't work, that ain't right, and here's how you live your life. And a lot of people are lost looking for a way. And whatever your way is, my way was martial arts.
What'd you get busted for?
Oh God, you name it. Pick one.
Armed robbery.
Nope, never did it. Never hurt a soul. Yeah, I've always been a gentle person, but
breaking and entering.
Breaking and entering, selling, receiving, grand theft, grand larceny.
What about drugs?
Never big on drugs. I never got busted for drugs. I did drugs, of course, we all did drugs, but I never got into the bad side of drugs, like the hard drugs or the things that I felt would change my mind. That always scared me, that my mind would be changed. Because I know I'm blessed with this body, but I know really I've been very successful because of my mind.
When you were in prison, did you fight a lot?
Nope. Got in 3 fights. And I won every one, but they were all because, you know, somebody tried to take something from me, and that's not how it rolls.
How long were you in for?
3.5 years, 18 to 21. Yeah. I went to prison when I was 18 years old, and I voluntarily transferred myself to state prison out of California Youth Authority because that was the only way I could be next to my wife and my son and earn money for them. So I took myself to state prison when I was 18. Now that's strong, Mike.
Wow.
That's what I believe you do for your family.
Now you are one of the most world-famous MMA fighters ever to live. You are a broadcaster on national television and on pay television, Showtime. You're in games. You're an author. You are the epitome of the American dream, aren't you?
I hope so. I mean, this is what you can do. I graduated from continuation school. You know, I did most of my work in juvenile halls. You know, I know that there's a better way out there. And hey, it may not be closing a fist and getting into a cage, but for some people it is. And for some people it's just the idea of training with other people that think that that's important. You know, it's just the community needed. I grew up without a family. I gave up my family because my family sucked. And this is my family.
Do you come across people in fights that remind you of you and you want to tell them there is another way? They're not just stuck in one pattern.
All the time. Everybody. Even just regular old people. Just your run-of-the-mill guys come through my school. They come by years later and say, wow, I never knew what we were doing or why we were doing it, but I appreciate you doing it. That to me is worth it.
We'll be right back.
Coming up next on Fighting Words with Mike Straka.
You said that Ken embarrassed the Shamrock name. Have you spoken to him since then about that incident?
That's coming up next on Fighting Words with Mike Straka. Welcome back to Fighting Words with Mike Straka. This week's guest, Frank Shamrock.
Welcome back. Frank, let's talk about Kimbo Slice for a minute. Kimbo Slice, somebody you were familiar with from Elite XC. Guy's got 10 million views on his YouTube fights, and now he's in UFC fighting, fought Houston Alexander, was on the Ultimate Fighter reality show. Is he good or bad for the sport?
I think he's good. He's bringing eyeballs to the set. Whether he keeps them there, that's our job. We're the production people. We put on the shows. But whoever's bringing eyeballs is good. Whatever their message is, you know, that's give or take. I don't think he really has a message, does he? Go out and fight?
Likes to stand up, stand and bang is what he says.
Yeah, I don't really think there's a message there. It's just people like him. Anybody that people like and they want to see fight, you should put them out there.
Let's talk about that one fateful night when he was supposed to fight your brother, Ken. And Ken cut his eye, and you came out and said that was deliberate. He cut his eye on purpose.
Do
you believe that?
Here's what I honestly believe. I don't believe anybody who has been a professional as long as he has would put himself in a situation that will allow himself to be cut. Because when there are millions and millions and millions of dollars riding on one event, you don't take that chance. That's how I roll. And to think otherwise to me is unprofessional and could only be done with malice.
So you think he was out to sabotage the show, not so much that he was afraid to fight Kimbo, but maybe to hurt you and to hurt the promotion?
No, I don't think it was about. I don't think it was that far thought. But I think that Ken was upset that he wasn't being compensated like Kimbo was. And I think that, you know, and for a guy who's been there since the beginning, for a new guy to walk on two or three matches in and to literally be making twice as much money, I can see why he'd be upset, but that's where professionalism and the business comes in. Go out and beat him, and then tell him what you want.
You would have stepped into the cage that night, wouldn't you?
I was ready to step in the cage. I had gear being brought to the ring. I had verbal clearance from Armando Garcia, and I had, up until an hour before that show, thought I was going to fight Kimbo in the main event.
Wow.
Yeah, which was really a mind twist. It was pretty hard to shift from being scared out of my mind and commentating on CBS to being scared out of my mind and fighting Kimbo.
But that would have been historic.
Yeah. I mean, it would have been a great story, and it may or may not have saved the opportunity in the show, but the past is the past, you know? I felt at that moment somebody had to do something, and I was willing to step up.
Were you surprised when Seth Petruzzelli knocked him out?
I was definitely surprised. I wasn't shocked. You can't mix and match like that. The level is too high. There's too many probabilities. And so I knew it was a car accident waiting to happen. I just didn't know if it was going to wreck or where we were going with it. I felt bad. For me, it was like, oh man, here we go. I knew what the result was going to be.
You said that, and you said it right after the fight, that Ken embarrassed the Shamrock name that night. Have you spoken to him since then about that incident?
Nope. We don't talk. We're not what you call close.
Would you ever fight him?
Oh, yeah. I still want to, and I'm still working on it. We got to do it before he's like 60, because otherwise I'm going to look like a pretty bad dude beating him up out there. But for me, it's different. People, if you were my friend, Mike, I'd want to fight you. Yeah. Because that's how I would show you respect. That's how I would give you, that's how I would exchange with you. Right. I don't know another way. I grew up like this. To me, you know, if you were my teacher, I would show you the most amount of respect by kicking your ass. Because you deserve that. That's how I roll. That's why I don't leave my house very much, apparently.
So then what do you make of guys who say, I won't fight him because he's in my camp?
I think that's a wonderful, loving notion. And I think that when real money comes along, people mistake the act for everything. That's one moment. And I mean, one of my closest friends is Phil Baroni. You know, I've never talked to that guy until we fought. And now I text him every day. Because him and I are joined. We experience something nobody else in this world will ever experience. And he's the only guy that gets it. And that's kind of how it is for me. I don't think of it like I shouldn't, you know, I'm worried about this guy, I'm worried about that guy. Let him beat me. I'll beat him. We're supposed to be warriors. Yeah.
How do you like being a broadcaster?
If I were not so nervous, I would really enjoy it.
Why are you nervous, though? It's not rocket science. You're not saving lives out there.
You know what? I know. But I grew up not wanting attention placed on me. And of course, I got into a job where all the attention was on me, and then I'm standing in front of a camera. I just battle with this thing. When I'm performing physically, there's a realm of physical that, you know, I'm floating. No one's there. It's just me. I'm floating. I'm doing my thing. I got
utopia.
The runner side. Yeah, I'm there. It doesn't matter. When you're standing in front of a camera and you're working with an inanimate object and you're kind of, you know, bring those emotions out, that's challenging for me.
Well, you know, what's interesting, though, is when you're fighting,
yeah,
it is about you.
Yeah.
And when you're on camera, it's not about you.
It's about them. But all
so
I can,
you should be more comfortable in front of the camera.
I don't know.
Just look at it that way. You'll be fine.
I'm going to try that. I get uncomfortable, and I don't know why. Yeah, and I'm working on it.
You know, when we were younger, movies like Vision Quest were inspirational, you know, to wrestlers. And Rocky for boxers. And even The Karate Kid for young, aspiring martial artists. Today, it's hard to watch. It's hard to be inspired by a film in Hollywood when you actually can turn a TV on and see the real thing. So what do we do now?
Ah, are you ready for this? The new action heroes are real action heroes. They can actually fight. And they can actually do all that stuff that the stuntmen usually do for them and that they make up. I think that's the future, is guys like George St. Pierre that you go, you know, I want you to do a backflip and then kick that guy in the head. And they go, all right, let's do it. Because they can. I just think that we're in that era now. The reality is so real, they want a real action hero.
Yeah.
And he's coming. I don't know, I might be too old to be that guy, but he's coming. He's definitely coming.
You're so cerebral. I mean, I hear you can read a book in 2 days. Is that true?
I can, yeah. I just read Andre Agassi's memoirs.
Open.
Very good, yeah.
Were you surprised by his admission to doing crack cocaine? Or
No. I mean, I wasn't surprised. I'm glad that he did in ways that I think he needed to tell.
Frank, why does a guy who's seemingly on top of the world do something like that? I mean, why does Tiger Woods do what he did? I mean, what is it? Are athletes like you who are elite athletes, is it all or nothing all the time?
I think a lot of it is that feeling. I walk into my house and I got to take the trash out. I got to straighten up the laundry. I got to, you know, vacuum the floor. I walk into an arena and it's 20,000 people chanting my name. It's just, we live in a different world. I mean, I live in a different world. I know I'm not like everybody else because I eat room service 3 times a day. And all I do is work out and then go do these television shows and this kind of stuff. I know what I'm doing is very, very different. Those people are on a completely different level than I am. And they have millions and millions and millions of dollars. And if you really want to find out people's nature, give them unlimited amounts of cash and let them do whatever they want. And unfortunately, you know, a lot of people, human nature is, take as much as you can and, you know, break the rules. So I've been guilty of it, man. I'm no angel. I've been to prison. I've been to jail. I've been, you know, I just know that that's not what I want to do and where I want to keep going. You know, I've had a girl in every city. I've done all that stuff. And everybody does it. But you're not supposed to do it when you grow up and have a family and you become responsible.
Yeah, how do you stay so disciplined? I mean, it's easy to get caught up in that world.
Yeah. I keep normal, regular people around me. And I do normal, regular things. And it's a struggle because I don't know how to talk to people. Everybody looks at me like I'm Frank Shamrock and I'm the commentator. Nobody stops and asks me personal questions or how I'm doing or hangs out because there's this other thing in front of them. So I keep normal, regular people around me so they know what's going on. They can tell me who's real and who's not.
Speaking of normal, regular people, we're watching some people put up the cage right now. And, you know, in this economy where our nation is in a recession, I mean, what does MMA do?
I just think that society is moving into a new era, in a new era of entertainment. Reality is done. This is reality. So I just think that we've gone so far that this is the sport for the time and for the society. And I think that, you know, people flock to it because they're frustrated. You know, you have a bad day at work, you don't get to curse your boss out. I have a bad day at work, I go in and kick my boss's ass. I feel great at the end of the day. I don't know how you feel. Imagine the frustration building in people.
Yeah.
Think about it. You got a job you don't want to be at that you have to do and you don't know what you're doing. I get to go home and beat the crap out of my friends every single day.
And they like it.
And they like it. And they come back and they thank me for it. And I'm thanking them. It's just a different, I think it's different. I think society needs this now.
Now, inside MMA's Boss Rutan and you have a history, Hank Grace, and I understand those were some crazy bouts, weren't they?
Yeah, they were. Boss was my first professional fight ever. So the reason why my nose looks like this is because of Boss Rutan. He kicked me with a shoe and broke the end of my nose off. But the greatest part about fighting Boss is Boss talks to himself and then inadvertently talks to you. So the first time I'm fighting him, I'm new, I'm green, I'm out there going for it, I'm working on his legs, and all of a sudden he goes, oh, my legs are so strong. And I stop and I go, wait a minute. I go, well, hold on a second. And I go back to work on him and he goes, they are too strong. You cannot break them. And I go like, what is this guy? And I'm new to business. I'm a young kid. The whole 10 minutes went like that. And it was like this one-sided conversation that Boss was having with himself and me. And it was the weirdest thing ever. And then we'd go out and just party like the world was going to end and then show up 6 weeks later and do it again. It's awesome.
And that's one of the most awesome things about this sport is how you guys, after you beat the crap out of each other, hug it out at the end.
Oh, yeah.
It's respect, isn't it?
Yeah, and especially in the Pancrase League where we all started, you know, every 6 weeks you'd go back and you'd see the same guys. And you could either rip that heel out or you could hold it and let him tap. Because you know you're going to see him in 6 weeks. You know you're going to fight him and his brother and his uncle and everybody else. So I really developed a sporting type kind of feel to my game. I wouldn't break a guy's leg. If I had the chance, I'd hold it. If he didn't tap, I'd let it go. And it came back to bite me when John Lober kicked the crap out of me in 97 because I wouldn't break his leg. But once I got over that and started breaking legs, everything was good. But there was like a camaraderie, a brotherhood that was really nice.
It is true, though, what they say about nice guys finishing last, isn't
it? They do, yeah. Yeah, I fought John for 20 minutes, or 30 minutes. It was a 30-minute fight. And I got tired in 5 minutes because I had him in 15 holds. And I realized he wasn't going to give up and I wasn't going to break his leg. Or his arm or shoulder. So after 5 minutes, he just beat the crap out of me for 25 minutes. And I left there $10,000 poor and decided that I'm breaking every leg and arm and finger that gets in front of me, and that if I'm going to be a warrior, we're killing people. We're not just playing.
You know, Dana White always says if you have a baseball game in one corner or a football game in another corner and a hockey game in another corner and a fight breaks out in the fourth corner, everybody stops what they're doing and watches the fight. Do you find that around the world? I mean, fighting is universal, isn't it?
Yeah, fighting is universal. It goes back to the core of how we got to here. We survived a fight. Everybody gets it. And it's, you know, it doesn't need languages. It's fighting is fighting.
Frank, man, thanks so much for opening up. Really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
Frank Shamrock.
This has been an exclusive presentation of HDNet.